안녕하십니까?
Hello everyone. I'm Son Young-hee of the Ijeon Dental Clinic. Today, we're going to talk about wide and short implants, how useful they are, and when we need to use them, and what are the things we need to watch out for and consider when using these types of implants. So I hope that you will learn a lot from this course. So, ultra-wide implant. Now, there is also wide implant. So, it's quite used commonly. So, in terms of TS-based, you have 3 to 7 millimeters implant lineup, and regular implants we usually call up to 5 millimeters, and if it's more than 5 millimeters, I mean we also have 5.5, but up to 6, 7 millimeters, we'll call them ultra wide implant. And also US or SS do have ultra-wide implants. Then, this wide implants, where do you place them? First, you have to have the right indication for it, using it. So, focolingual width, I think, needs to be more than 9 millimeters to place them. And I think minimum it should be 9 millimeters in diameters, and to be on the safe side, 10 millimeters of ledge is where this type of implant would be good for. And right after extraction, if you want to place immediate implant placement to narrow the open area, you typically use this wide types of implants. And sometimes it's also used where after removing the implant, you have to do immediate placement of another implant, like using EFR kit without hurting the bone. If you have removed the bones, then you might not need to use the ultra-wide implant. But if you have used Triffin burr to remove the implant, then inevitably you have to use very wide implants. And in such case, ultra-wide implant would be a good option. And last indication would be residual bone height is not sufficient. Rather, in that case, wider implant and shorter in length implant, that type of wide or ultra wide implants are what you usually use. Then let's look at short implants. Now, wide and short implants always go together. Typically, in case of 6 millimeter or more implant that is long, we use them also. But for the ultra wide implants, we also use them for short implants also. So the bone height, in other words, is insufficient. To solve the situation surgically, you could do vertical augmentation to create bone, or you could also do nerve repositioning to before placing the implant. But I think the most common case would be where short and wide width implant. So the surface is wider in diameter and using that. So in case there is insufficient bone height. So for short wide implant, the indication for using that type of indication is that in case of compromised height or in deficient ridge, we use that type of implant like this. And also here, another strength would be that in this type of ridge, you don't have much remodeling because remodeling have already been done. So there is no more remodeling in this ridge. So only base of the ridge exists. So it has a very wide width of ridge. In that case, short and wide implant can be used for restoration. And also, secondly, in case of peri-implantitis, in other words, there is a heavy bone loss. Even if you do augmented procedure, prognosis cannot be guaranteed. So in that case, short implant can be used as a rescue implant after peri-implantitis. So then, in what type of length do you define a short implant? Up to now, in various literature, there are different opinions, no consensus. In the past, short implant was less than 10 millimeters, but now commonly 7 to 10 millimeters are defined as short implant, but I think it's not also based on consensus, general consensus. So typically when we say short implant, what is the length? That is something I think we can discuss a bit more. So short implant is not only made by Osstem in different companies, it's been produced. Like for example, Straumann has up to 4 millimeters of length of implants, and for Astra also has diameters 4 and length 6 millimeters of implant. Bicon also has a very short implant. In case of Korean companies, there are also different short implants. The most variety of lineup, in my opinion, as far as I can confirm, is TS system. So in case of the Osstem short implants, you have US, SS, and TS all being produced. And typically, TS is most commonly used. And for diameter 7 millimeters, 4.5 millimeters, and 5 diameters, 6 millimeters is the typical size. And you can see 5 to 6, 5.5 to 6 millimeters, 6 to 6 millimeters, 7 to 6 millimeters. So it's up to 6 millimeters. This is inevitable because if it's less than 6 millimeters, it's not approved in Korea. So 6 millimeters is the limit. So the typical implant is only up to 6 millimeters that's being produced in Korea. Then in case of extra short implants, yes, they also do exist. Then how do we use that? Extra short implants have bevels, and in case of extra short implants, only is available up more than 4.5 or 4 diameters. So the colors has about 1 or 2 millimeters, and it only goes up to 6 millimeters. And also 5 to 6, the bevel, you have 1.2, 2.1 bevels. There are two versions, so it goes up to 5 to 4 millimeters. So typically what we can say is in case of 5 millimeters, 5 to 4 millimeters of implants is being produced. So how do you create bevel with that? So this bevel within can be exposed, or it can also go into the bone. That is what the bevel is. It you can determine this with the vertical location. So you only etch the bevel area, the SH surface, sandblasting and etching usually, but here in the bevel only you have etching. So it's very rough surface, but at the same time very low rough surface, and it only the thread part that is goes inside. You have sandblasting and etching to create micro pit. So the low rough surface, so when it goes in touch with the gingiva area, it's it's not so much inflamed. So the bevel area RA value is about 0.3 to 3.5. For thread, it's 2.5 to 3 RA value. So it's a difference in the roughness. Then you must say it's a rough surface. So how can it be exposed? to the outside. I mean, due to the difference in the roughness, as you can see from this picture. So then, we looked at wide and short implants. So where do we use in real cases? Let's look at some case presentations. So this is a female patient, 52 years old. And if you see, there is no teeth in the 30th area. And actually, if you look at her CT, number 36 and 37, ridge cross-sectional view looked like this. In other words, the ridge width is not very good. And height of the ridge is not, you know, very nice. It has even atrophy, and it's a challenge for implant placement. So we opted for short implant in the planning, and you used casket for precise drilling. So when you place short implant, you surgical kit, then you might use a tapered kit. And for this tapered drill in this kit, 1 millimeter can go in terms of room, and it's a wide dimension, so it goes 1.6 to 2 millimeters of extra drilling. That is the reality. But here in the posterior, on the lower side, if there's atrophy, there's not much of room. So if you go even 1.6 and 2 millimeters deeper, it could have impact on the canal. So you have to have understand wide dimension and gap for drilling. So for precise drilling in this area, is you stopper in the casket. I do believe that would be the best way, and then you could use probe to prevent or check whether it touches the mandibular canal. So, you know, on the mandible side, use casket is what I would recommend. So you drilled. Then for this patient, buccal augmentation, for that procedure, the cortical bone was perforated, and this type of implant was played for number 36 and 37. So we wanted to use wide implant, but it could not because ridge width was also unfavorable. So we could not use wide implant, and that is why we use short implant after bone grafting. Titanium and the membranes were covered and sutured up. So after surgery, this is the panorama view, and it doesn't show clear, but here, as you can see on CT number 36 canal distance, there is a bit of room, number 37, it's within safety margin from the canal. So prostheses were delivered without much issues. And the CT view when we deliver prosthesis. So number 37, as you can see, very precise drilling was necessary. And as you can see, mandibular canal, the distance, even if you use a 6 millimeter implant here, like this, very short area, is remaining. So with the canal, what should be the distance? Typically, safety margin is 2 millimeters, but for this patient, it's less than 2 millimeters. So if you go less than 2 millimeters, then even without going in direct contact with the canal during the healing period, in the mandible nerve, it could be compressed. So you have to be careful. So even if the, you know, distance is sufficient, you should not be think that everything can care of. You have to always think about safety margin. So today we talked about the wide and short implant. So summary. So when you use short and wide implant, you use mostly on the mandible side. So let's look at there first. So for mandible, if the residual bone height is 5 to 6 millimeters, that would be the criteria for decision making. If the answer is yes, then you have to use short implant. If it's less than 5 to 6, then I believe vertical augmentation or other ways to increase bone height needs to be done before you or simultaneously placing the implant. And for residual bone height, if it's more than 5 to 6 millimeters, then you could use a short implant. But if it's less than 5 millimeters, it could be challenging, then ultra short implant could be considered. Along with that, GBR procedure can be done with the minor GBR. You could increase bone height so that the implant can be surrounded by bones. That would be a very good option. And from the maxillar side, the bicortical fixation after doing sinus elevation would be a good approach. So in my opinion, wide implants could be, compared to a lower part, be not so necessary. So the diameter of the implant is not a critical point. So it's not a must for the maxillar area. So maybe regular fixtures could also be a consideration. So what I want to say, what you need to be careful is an ultra wide implant. If you use, rather than opting that from the get-go, the posterior side for male patient 5 millimeters, and if the occlusal force is weak, then 4.5 millimeters, you use that first. You always, in other words, need to think about there could be chance for using the rescue implant. So if you cannot secure initial stability, there should be room to move to one additional diameter, and that would be the safer approach. So ultra wide from the get-go on the posterior side, I should not be your initial approach. That would be my recommendation. So today we looked at the short and wide implants. Now, wide diameter implant, short or strong implant, it's something you need to consider very carefully, and looking at the patient status, and depending on the situation of surgery, if you are careful in opting which one to go, I think a chance of successful result would go up. Thank you for your attention.